Today I'm going to be replacing the alternator on Royal Enfield Bullet. This is a 2001 model. So step one, now I'm talking about the alternator stator, which is right in here on the left side of the bike. There's a magnet in the middle of it that rotates around, which generates the power. The wire comes out the back of the primary case here and goes up here into your electrical system. Now this is important. You want to look at where it plugs in. And you can see here, yeah, it's pretty dark. I don't know if it can adjust. See four wires there? So my alternator has four wires. There's an orange wire and a yellow wire which go to the headlight, because the headlight is an AC headlight on this particular bike. And then it has a black and a red wire which go to the regulator and rectifier and power the rest of the bike. So your bike might have a three-wire alternator or a four-wire alternator. You want to make sure which one you have before you order a replacement part. And you know, if you order them on eBay, there's some, I got mine from Bullet Walla on eBay. It was around $50 delivered from India to California, United States. And they have a lot of pictures on the site, so I can look at my current one and then compare it to the pictures that they have, and it looks the same. Now the one that you'll see me installing here is a heavy duty alternator stator. And the reason I'm doing that is because the previous owner put a heavy-duty one in here, so I want to put in the one that matches. If you're switching to a heavy-duty one, you'll also have to switch the magnet in the middle of it as well. And in my case, since I already have the heavy-duty magnet, I'm just going to put in the heavy-duty stator because I know that it'll work. I've been told that the regular one works fine, and there's really no reason to do a heavy-duty one unless you're planning on running electric vests and stereos and stuff, which most people with this type of bike probably would never do anyway. So let's get started. All right, the foot pegs on your Royal Enfield Bullet are adjustable for height, so you can actually unscrew this bolt and then take it off and make it lower or higher depending on how you want it. So you want to take something like a pencil or grease pencil or even paint if you want, and make a mark so that you'll know exactly what position it was in before you take it off. And then you want to take off the foot peg using this bolt, and then down here you want to remove the shift lever. There's a bolt on the back of it. We're going sideways here. So this bolt on the back of the shifter lever, and then you just pull it off the front or where this zerk is. You just grab it and pull it forwards. So we'll remove those and proceed. All right, foot peg comes off. All right, then you loosen up the bolt that holds the shifter tight. The bolt doesn't have to come all the way out for it to come loose. And put that aside. Now you want to make sure the bike is on the side stand so that you have room to put an oil catch pan under here. All right, the oil pan is in place. Now there's only one bolt that holds this cover on. It's really clever and great for maintenance. It's super easy to do. You just take your, what is this? Take your 18 millimeter wrench, stick it on there. Spin it loose. That's a bolt and a washer. And then the oil is just going to come out when we pop the cover off. Now the gasket around this should be reusable. They last a long time. The gasket you can see in here is like a big fat rubber band that fits into a groove, and that should be good for quite a while. So now we're looking at the stator. This is what we want to replace. Yours will probably not be as thick this way if you've got a stock one. This is, again, is the heavy duty one. And a stock one is, you know, maybe half the thickness or a little more than half the thickness of this one. And on the stock one, you will also have some washer shims here that you're not going to see when I take this off. This one, I had to remove the shims in order to fit it inside the case. All right, next we undo one, two, three bolts to remove the stator. All right, so now I've unplugged the stator from the electrical system back up here and routed the wire so it's going pretty much straight back that way through the wall here. And we're just going to pull the stator off and then pull the wire out. Now getting it through this hole, especially where the wire ends are. It's going to be a little tricky. So it's off. Because it's magnetic, it gives you a little resistance. Here we go. I'm going to pull the wires through one at a time. They're too big to get all four through at the same time. So now I've gotten all four of them out. And we can fit the new one. Now you can see how fat this magnet is. I do want to make sure that it's shimmed out properly. You can see it was this one was shimmed out with washers. In your case, if you're replacing a stock one with a stock one, there'll be a big fat spacer here, and you just put the stock one back exactly where the other one was. In this case, the guy had kind of shimmed it up in a funny way and had put the magnet on here, so I just want to make sure that the magnet lines up with these metal parts inside of the stator. So this, you want this to line up right with the middle of the magnet when you're shimming it out. And of course, leave enough room for you to be able to get the primary case back on. All right, at this point, it's a good idea to check the old part against the new part once you've got them out. Yeah, I've got the new part still in the plastic bag, but when I hold them up next to each other, the new part is maybe a millimeter or two slimmer than the old part. So I've got to make sure that I put enough washers in here on the studs to get these parts exactly right over the magnet. If I'm shifted too far left or right, then it won't generate as much electricity because the magnet won't be where it needs to be. All right, I've got it shimmed out and lined up properly. And we're gonna use a little bit of blue Loctite on the thread. All right, I'm in the process of aligning this thing. So for whatever reason, probably poor manufacturing quality, it's able to shift around. And if I bolt it down, if shifted too far forwards or too far to the side, then it's going to rub on the rotor, and that's not good. So what I'm going to do is just kind of keep shift it around until I've got it centered, and I can see light in between the rotor and all of the coil pickups. All right, so this is pretty hard to see. Let me throw some extra light in here. But if you can see daylight between the pickup and the magnet, then you're all right. So what I did was, because this thing shifts around, and if it's too far to one side or the other, then the pickup is gonna rub against the magnet. What I did was tightened it down just a little bit, all three bolts, so that it was semi-snug. And then I took something soft, in this case the padded end of a socket wrench, and just kind of banging on it from side to side gently to get it to move until I could see daylight between all of the pickups and the magnet. So now the magnet is not going to rub on the pickups. I apologize if they're not officially called pickups. I'm too tired to go look up the official term if that's not the term, but and I apologize for teenage girls in the background. Bye. But it works. It took me a long time to get it tuned because it kept jumping to the magnet. So be patient and just keep trying. I found that if I shine a light behind it and then look directly through between the rotor and the pickup, it helps me to be able to see the light behind it if there is clearance, and you see no light if there's no clearance. So I hope that made sense. Now we're gonna run the wire through, and then we'll be good. So now again, the wire's coming off of the front. If the wire's coming off of the back, then you put it in backwards and you gotta go redo it. But coming off of the front and going through the top here through this little rubber thing. Now, since it's a four wire setup, if you try to cram all four of these through the hole at the same time, you'll find out that it's too big for the hole. And so you want to do two, and then shove in two more right behind it. So let's start out with the purple ones. Those will be the purple ones. Some of these four wire alternators have black and red, and some of them have purple. So I'm going to shove those through
to the other side.
Actually, I think I'm going to do one at a time. All right, one goes through easy.
Wish I had smaller fingers or longer wires here. And then the second one,
shove it through. That goes through easy. Pull them out. Can you see them on the other side there? Can see them coming out here.
And then we'll shove the another purple one through there.
So the purple one is through, so that's three wires through. And then we just shove the fourth one through. And then pull the wire through from the back to the where you hook it up to the electrical system. All right, that was pretty easy. Here we go, feeding it through, feeding the black wire through here. Twisted. Being gentle. Now you can buy new rubber dealies to keep the oil from leaking out on top of your case. Now I replaced that when I was in here doing the primary earlier, so I'm not going to bother replacing it, but you can buy those new to replace it. It's a smart thing to do, because to replace it you have to remove the alternator wire. So you don't want to have to do that just to fix a leak if you're replacing the alternator anyway. Alright, cool. Now we just plug it in to, it's pretty dark in my garage and it's pretty dark up here in the electrical system, but the four wires are right over here, and I'm just going to plug purple ones into the purple ones and the orange one into the orange one and the yellow one into the yellow, and then it should work. Alright, with a little help from my flashlight here, you can see all the wires are plugged into their appropriate colors. Purple into purple and orange and yellow into orange and yellow. Now, as long as you've got this all opened up, you might want to check the tension on the primary chain and see if you need to adjust it. What you want to do is just make sure that you have about a quarter inch of movement up and down in the place where the this is the checker. So you want to, on the primary cover, right where that checker would interface with the chain, right about here, you just want to make sure that you have a quarter inch of play up and down, but not much more than that. And of course, rotate it to a bunch of different times and keep checking the tension, because the chain might be stretched out one way or the other. And if you need to make it tighter, you just loosen up this lock nut down here and raise up the plastic primary chain tensioner. You can watch my primary chain video to see me do it more in depth. Right now, I just want to get this thing back on the road. All right, so let's get the cover back on. I love this part because it's so easy. And of course, I'm cleaning out the inside of the cover with a paper towel just to get any crud off of it. There we go. It just goes on like that. And then this guy goes right in the middle. Now, like I said, the gasket is probably fine and doesn't need to be replaced. It's a pretty tough gasket. Which one of my dog bones it was? Ah, this one. Okay, there we go. We just tighten that up. You don't need to torque the hell out of it. Just tighten it snug so it's compressing down the rubber band. Rubber band to gasket. I'm happy with that. Then you want to get it on the center stand so that we can fill it up with the lubricant of your choice. The lubricant of my choice is Type F automatic transmission fluid. I've been told that that's good for the kickstart models, and then people use motor oil if they've got an electric starter. Supposedly that keeps the starter lubricated and makes it last longer. But if you don't have the electric starter, then the transmission fluid is better.
All right, I'm going to go ahead and put the foot peg and the shifter back on. Now, I took the shifter off first, so I'll be putting that back on first.
All right, now I put the foot peg back on. Again, remembering that I made marks to line up how high or low I want it to be.
So I'm putting it back the same way it was when I took it off. And the reason for doing that is if it's higher or lower than the foot peg on the other side, it'll just feel funny when you're riding your bike. Also, you might not be able to corner as hard as you used to, and that can cause some problems if you accidentally put it on lower.
All right, now I've got the bike on the center stand, and I've got the kickstand swung out of the way because there's a bolt under here that I'm going to remove. I'm going to remove this bolt. This is where the top bolt is where you can check the primary chain tension and also where you're supposed to add your oil or transmission fluid. And then the bottom bolt you remove and you dump oil in the top until it comes out the bottom. And once it starts coming out the bottom, then you know it has enough oil in it and you stop and put the bottom bolt back in. So real simple. That's what we're doing. And on the bottom bolt, you can see I've got a magnet stuck to it just so that there's no filter in here or anything else. So this powerful magnet on this steel bolt picks up any metal chunks that are magnetic that might otherwise be flying around in the primary case. Here's my screwdriver. So unscrew the bottom bolt. Get my paper funnel, my Type F automatic transmission fluid. And just dump it in here until it runs out the bottom. Make sure you have a pan of some kind underneath so as not to make a mess on your garage floor or living room floor or wherever you happen to be doing this job. That didn't seem like enough. Now the positioning of the top hole is directly above the bottom hole. So it's possible that the transmission fluid is going in there and just coming out the bottom hole. Actually, maybe. I put about a quarter of a quart in so far. All right, so now I'm at the point where every time I dump some in the top, it comes out the bottom, so I'm satisfied that it is as full as it needs to be, so I'll just plug it up and take it for a test ride, see if I have electricity. Alright, so now to make sure that the new alternator is doing its job, we want to check the light circuit by kickstarting it and seeing if the headlight lights up. The headlight is running on AC, so if the headlight lights up, that's power is coming directly from the alternator, which means the headlight circuit is working. And then you want to check the ampmeter and make sure that it's in the green and not in the red, which will let you know that the DC side of the alternator is also working, or the side that feeds the regulator and rectifier, which turn it into DC. So let's kick it over and see what we get. And let's see, here we've got light at the headlight.